This show is presented by the 323 Network. You can watch all your favorite 323 friends and shows on the 323 Network YouTube channel, follow us on all social media platforms at 323Reed, and support us as we continue to grow at patreon.com/323Reed. That's 323-R-E-I-D. Luis Martinez, he's in a world of green pain. He's our resident Jets fan, the casually confident Jets fan that I think took a little bit of a hit on Monday night. Yeah, he's wearing black in mourning.
Yeah,
we should have all worn black. I think I fucked that up. Maybe I need to put on black. but we're going to get you in. We're going to get you out. And before, because you got important stuff to do, of course, you can find him at Big Chief Burrito, all the social media platforms, 2 a.m. Burrito, you know, Mi Gente Show, Fireside Chats. He's an important guy. He's doing big stuff right now. So let's get your thoughts. I need to hear your instant thoughts on what happened to Aaron Rodgers on Monday Night Football, his debut as a New York Jet, and how have you proceeded to bring everything in since?
All right. Well, I'm live right here right now from San Diego, California. It's one of the most beautiful cities in the world. I'm in Barrio Logan. I'm at a La Bamba-themed speakeasy having a great drink, a cocktail, but I'm dressed in black because we can't have nice things as a Jets fan. It's pain and pain and more pain. The most interesting thing about Monday night is that the minute I turned the game on, I got to my house like 5 minutes late and they said Aaron Rodgers is at the blue tent. I already knew what had happened. I was already 100% sure that it was bad news. And I wasn't even shocked. As a Jets fan, I believe that Joe Namath made a deal with the devil. And he said, I'm going to do against sports karma. I'm going to guarantee a Super Bowl win. And I don't care if my franchise is cursed for the next 50 years. And this is us 50 years later, still cursed, still dreaming, still not being able to have nice things. The worst part is that I wasn't shocked. We were waiting for the other shoe to drop since the season started. You know, this happened in 1999 with Vinny Testaverde. This happened with Chad Pennington. This happened with Mark Sanchez getting hurt in a meaningless preseason Snoopy Bowl. This happened when Bill Belichick was coach for a day. This happened when Peyton Manning decided to go back to school when we had the number one draft pick. It's nothing but pain. All I see is dark. Everything is black. My soul, my heart, everything. I'm in a glass. I'm in a glass case of emotion, as Anchorman said. It's appropriate that I'm here. But I'm drinking away my pain. I'm smoking away my pain. And I'm a little bit... the only good thing is that, you know, we have a top three defense. Our defense is full of fucking studs. And Aaron Rodgers is a fucking stud, and he's going to come back from this. He's not going to go out like that. He can't possibly go out after 75 seconds. In Zach we trust. Ugh, I almost threw up saying that right now. You know, I'm saying, like, what do you want me to do? Say, you know, Carson Wentz is going to come through that door and save the day. Nick Foles, Big Nick is going to come through that door and save the day. Look, we're going to have to fucking muddle through. We're going to have our defense. We're going to have to win a lot of 16 to 13 games. Our fucking rookie undrafted stud wins the fucking game in overtime. It's like a little bit of sweetness. That fucking Wisconsin bar that was going to pay people's tabs. When the people that went to that Wisconsin bar got washed because they were cheering when Rodgers got hurt, and then they had to pay their own fucking bar tab when the Jets won it and won play in overtime. I don't know what else to say, Reed. I mean, you know, I'm out here for the 3-2-2 representing for the green out here in San Diego and California, you know, loving representing New York and the Jets every day. It's hard. I had my green hat on. I had my fucking Jets shirt on. And it's pain, but like I said, I think I'm still in one of the stages of grief because I had never let myself get to the point where I thought it was real. I had never let myself get to the point where I was happy that Aaron Rodgers was our quarterback. I was always holding back. I never went full in. I know I picked them to go to the Super Bowl, and I was just sort of trying to talk, faking it till I make it. But it's just rough, man. I guess it must be what being a Commanders fan is like, you know. Sure. But even worse. And now I have to ride or die where you're fucking poverty franchise, so I don't have to get stuck in a Waffle House for 24 hours. So you know, I'm out here. You know, I'm still living my life. We're doing things in San Diego. You guys are always welcome to come out. I'm trying to sort of keep a brave face because we still have a top fucking three defense. We still got Garrett Wilson. We still got Sauce Gardner. We still got the cue ball in the middle of the fucking line destroying shit. We fucking we intercepted George Allen three times. We won on the last second. We didn't fucking die. We didn't crumble. So the best we can hope for is that we muddle on, go like 6-5, and then at the trading deadline, maybe one of these teams is out of it and we get a quarterback, or I don't know, maybe Zach. Maybe Aaron Rodgers can like ratatouille Zach Wilson and live inside his helmet and like save him. You know, hopefully you guys are still there. Yep. So, you know, that's where I'm at.
Zoo, I like how we caught astray when he's the one that might be relying on Carson Wentz's broken ass trying to heave a pick six down a little bit later.
Like, Carson doesn't do well with bad O-lines. He doesn't do well with good O-lines.
Would you rather have Carson Wentz or Zach Wilson?
I would rather have Zach Wilson.
Oh, Zach got him.
Perfect timing.
New York was like, shut up. Carson was like, shut up.
The universe said, get the fuck out of here.
No, everything that he was saying is it was hard to feel too bad for him because it was nothing we haven't said on a seasonal basis, but
it's where we're at. Look, the universe said, fuck you. We're moving on. We're going, we're getting your picks now. The Jets. It's what you expect with the Jets. It's honestly, like, Luis, I felt so bad for Jets fans as a whole. I felt bad for you when it happened. But I think everybody that's not a Jets fan, when they saw what happened and started to figure it out, everybody had the same reaction of, damn, that sucks.
Yeah, not again. That's exactly what we were feeling, man. Like we were waiting for it. We were cautiously optimistic, but some people were buying in. But like the real true lifers that have been in the fucking hurt for 20, 30 years, we knew it was like too good to be true that we were going to have a fucking competent quarterback for one time in our lives. You know, I talked about the stats, you know, Aaron Rodgers' worst 5 years would be the best 5 years any Jets quarterback has ever had. So there you go.
There we go. Well, look, we're not going to hold you up too much longer. We're going to get into what we're here for, and we're going to let you knock them right out. Ladies and gentlemen, again, this is the 3-2-3, and if you're listening to us on a Friday, that means it is Ricks versus Gricks NFL Week 2.
Life.
Yeah, sometimes.
Death. Time. Space. Forget everything you think you know. Put your money on the line. It's time for Ricks versus Gricks. Gricks?
That's right. Ricks versus Gricks, our weekly NFL picks, sometimes NBA, where it's Reed's picks versus Griffin's picks. Griffin is lost somewhere in that purple ether behind us. Now we have the new Grick. Well, we thought we did. It was Scott Ellia who's joining us, the host of 3-2-3 College Shame Day. And, you know, after a little while, we started to believe it might be Luis Martinez who was taking over during the playoffs. But, and I mean, I never had a chance. I'm the Ricks here. I'm Reed's picks. And last week I went 2-4. Scott, you know, the alleged Grick, he went 5-1. He went 5-1. He did really well. The attempted coup Grick, Luis Martinez, went 2-4 with me. But we have a contender for that Grick title now. We have he looks much more awake this week. But last week, on 5 hours of sleep over the course of several days, the new contender for the Grick title, going 5-1 and was so damn close to 6-0. Zuhair Ali. Zoo.
I should have gotten half a point for Aaron being on his ass.
You did call it. You called that part.
Never quite got up from it either. That deserves half a point.
So look, we will dive into each game individually between the three of us, but we're going to get Luis's picks so he can get out of here and get on to these important things. So the games that we have this week are the Chicago Bears 0-1 at the Tampa Bay Buccaneers, the Washington Commanders at the Denver Broncos, the Baltimore Ravens at the Cincinnati Bengals, the Green Bay Packers at the Atlanta Falcons, the New York Jets at the Dallas Cowboys, and the Kansas City Chiefs at the Jacksonville Jaguars. So, Luis, who do you have this week for each game?
All right. So, you guys hear me still?
Yeah, yep. We got you.
All right, cool. So, I'm going to take the Buccaneers at home against the Bears because they did show something last week. I have to fucking ride with your poverty franchise, the Commanders, because of a bet we made that I wasn't present for because I'm calling collusion and F. Scott. So, we're going to ride with the Commanders all year long. I'm going to take the Salamanders. We're going to take the Bengals at home versus the Ravens. We're going to take the Packers. We have the Packers because I think they're for real as well against the Falcons. You think I came all the way out to Barrio Logan to have drinks with my friends to then be on a podcast out in the middle of the streets and not pick the fucking New York Jets? You got another fucking thing coming. We're taking the J-E-T-S Jets. And winning by 3 points against the Dallas fucking Cowboys because fucking let's go, Zach. And we're going to take the Chiefs to bounce back at the Jaguars.
All right. There you heard it. Look, he's trying to make a comeback. It can't happen 2 weeks in a row where Luis Martinez is going to go 2-4. It's not going to happen. It's not going to happen.
And I'm awake, so you have a chance.
I mean, you never know. It's a wild week.
We'll see. I don't know. I don't know how I went 2-4, but somehow I went like 11-5 in your group picks. So I'm trying to stay consistent here. I was going to blame it on not having the picks ahead of time. So we'll see how it goes. But either way, I'm riding with the Jets all year. I'm riding with your Commanders all year. I'm never picking against my team because as fucking bad as it is, I'm going to bleed green till I die. So hope you guys have a good rest of your show. This is me from San Diego saying peace out. And hopefully I'll be in a better place mentally for next week, but let's keep this shit going. All right, 3-2-3.
Get that green back on, bud.
Enjoy, buddy. Have a good night.
All right, guys. Luis. Peace out, guys.
We got good picks there. He's got some good picks, and it helps me, start to get ahead of myself so I can actually figure out who I'm going to take in these picks. He's still staring at us, but frozen, and I kind of hope he stays there in the corner of the screen for the rest of the night. Well, I'm not going to mess with it. I'm going to leave him right there. So you heard the games, guys. We have the first one up here, the Chicago Bears, who are 0-1 at the Tampa Bay Buccaneers, who are 1-0, a surprising 1-0 from last week. Tampa Bay is a 2.5-point favorite at home. Bears got blown the fuck out by Green Bay. And I don't know. You don't know what's real and what's not real from week one. And that's more true than ever now that the preseason really doesn't matter and people really don't take it seriously whatsoever. But who will make a comeback? Oh, he left. I love that. I like that frozen face. Scott, I'm going to ask you here. Are the Tampa Bay Buccaneers for real in this game? Are they going to win or will the Bears take it?
No, I am heavily favoring the Buccaneers, especially with them being at home. I was impressed with Baker's performance last week. I mean, he was even deciphering defensive play calls from on the field, where most times you have like your third string quarterback just sitting there, just watching the other team, trying to pick up on their clues. And he was just dissecting that all game long. I think the Bears are still one of those sneaky teams, especially with how dangerous their rush offense can be with such a dynamic quarterback in Justin Fields, who needs to rely on his legs more times than not. But you're still going against a really stout Tampa Bay defense, so I got to go with the Bucs.
All right. Zuhair?
I think I need to take back what I said last week about the NFC South just being absolute garbage. I think they're recyclable garbage right now. The fact that all of them put up a fight as much as they did, and some of them even winning games, was very surprising. So I am going to give it to the Bucks this week. Because as high as I was as the Bears winning the division, that did not look like a playoff contending team. So I'm going to be buying somebody lunch. I think that's what the bet was. But for the sake of this week, we're going to go with the Bucks defense just stomping on the Bears.
Double fanfare for that. I was impressed by everything that I saw stat-wise from the Tampa Bay Buccaneers, and who knows where the credit's really going to. I'm happy for Baker, and I said last year when Baker got to Carolina, I was like, shit, he was the number one overall pick. There's got to be something there, and he didn't look terrible. He wasn't terrible in Cleveland, but he was terrible in Carolina. I don't know what happened with Minnesota last Sunday, especially at 1 p.m. That's their prime time. So I want to still believe in the Chicago Bears. I want to believe in Justin Fields and that skill set that he's got. I think he and DJ Moore are really finally going to start to get that connection going. The defense of, you know, with Tremaine Edmonds, they'll get it going. I think Baker will falter a little bit, and the Bucks will come back a little bit more to reality. I can't see them being 2-0, so I am going with the Chicago Bears in this one.
That's fair.
Next game up, we have Zoo's Baltimore Ravens, who are 1-0 at the Cincinnati Bengals, who are 0-1.
I picked up my helmet. There was a list, sir.
Cincinnati is a 3.5-point favorite in this game. Scott, who are you taking?
I am going to go with Cincinnati. I think Joe Burrow and Cincinnati looked very just pedestrian last week in Cleveland. It's a very, you can't drop two games in the AFC North with how competitive it's going to be this year. You're at home. It's going to be a really close game. I only got him by 3, but I'm going to have the Bengals edging him out.
All right. Zoo, who do you want here?
I think it's actually going to be the Ravens.
Okay.
I don't know why the Bengals are having such a slow start, but they notoriously have a, you know, mid defense with a bleh O-line. And I think the Ravens defense is going to capitalize on that. I think it might still be a low scoring game. But the Ravens' weapons with how tough their defense is might be what gets them through.
Okay. How'd you like that fight between the Commanders fans and a random drunken Ravens fan?
I don't know what the context was, but as I was watching it, all I could say is he probably deserved it.
I mean, for
those elbows to his face were just beautiful.
I think the story behind that video that's even more funny is that, Reid, you sent Zoo the video, and then I found a video, and I sent it to Zoo, and I had no idea that you had already sent it to him.
So I screenshot our conversation and sent it to him, I didn't have to repeat my response.
We just know. We know Zoo would love to see that. That was, as soon as I saw it, I thought of Zoo.
I've watched it so many times.
Look, this game... I'm going to roll with the majority on this one. I'm taking Cincinnati. I think they'll get it around. I'm willing to credit more of what happened in week one to that new Jim Schwartz defense in Cleveland. I mean, it's hard. Myles Garrett was coming from every fucking angle. They played, Jim Schwartz had him coming out at middle linebacker and rushing up the middle. And he was doing like basketball moves before the snap. Because he was just letting them know, hey, I'm going to break right past you and fuck Burrow up. And he did it. He just went and did it. I think Myles Garrett is an early contender for Defensive Player of the Year, along with Micah Parsons. So you can't, I can't see Cincinnati dropping two in a row as badly as they look. Burrow will have, he can afford a bad game every now and then. That was it. He will get it going against Baltimore. Baltimore's still a little banged up in the secondary. And now they've lost J.K. Dobbins. They've lost their starting running back. They're back to that committee approach. Who knows what their offense is going to, you know, if it's going to take a little bit of a hit, see if they can get Odell Beckham going, rely more on Zay Flowers. We don't know. I think Cincinnati gets it together. You can't doubt Burrow and Ja'Marr Chase and T. Higgins and Boyd, all of that. Give me the Cincinnati Bengals. Now, Zoo, you can pick up your helmet because our next game up are the Washington Commanders, who are 1-0, undefeated, at the Denver Broncos, who are 0-1. But Denver is a 3.5-point favorite at home. So, Scott, who are you taking here?
You know, all before last week's game, going into this, I would have picked the Commanders pretty quickly. But I think with how close of a game the Commanders did have last week with Arizona, it gives me a little bit of worry, especially they're going to be on the road in Denver at that game. I think it's going to be another one of those really close, under a touchdown kind of win. And if that's the case, I usually give the tie goes to the home field advantage. I'm going to give it to Denver.
Zoo holding up a Washington Commanders helmet to his chin. Who are you taking in this game?
Yeah, I'm not really confident in this game at all, and I feel like it is going to be close to what the Commanders-Cardinals game was like. Just a very defensive battle, low scoring, lots of struggles because, you know, they're going to take advantage of our O-line and take advantage of a new quarterback. But at the same time, Russell Wilson's not using his legs, and our pass rush is quite menacing now. So I feel like that's what's going to get us the win, is just defensive pressure and a couple of magical plays from Sam Howell. But it's going to be low scoring. It's going to be tough, but the Commanders are going to take it away.
I have to agree with you on that. I am also taking the Commanders. I think that exactly what you said, the our pass rush versus their O-line and Russell's depleted mobility is a lethal combination. I think that we'll eat them up on their offensive side of the ball. We'll get some good turnovers on there. Hopefully our offense can capitalize. Hopefully we keep the ball away from Antonio Gibson. And I like the idea that if I thought I saw something on the injury report about Pat Surtain. If Terry is going to be going exclusively against him, I like the matchup for Jahan Dotson on the other side. I like Dotson being able to have a big game. I like Curtis Samuel getting more and more involved in this offense. I think he fits really well for Eric Bieniemy. Just hopefully our O-line can hold up just enough and Sam Howell can keep that confidence going. Hopefully make some more big plays with his legs. We'll see, though.
Hopefully Logan Thomas can keep the ball in his hands.
Yeah, that too.
Well, and you bring up a good point with Bieniemy too, coming from Kansas City, and he would face Denver two times every year for the last damn near decade. If anyone on that coaching staff or in that building that understands that team, it's going to be him. So that's a nice little ace in the back pocket.
Mm-hmm. So that's our picks on that one. Next game up, we have the Green Bay Packers, who are 1-0, at the Atlanta Falcons, who are also 1-0. Green Bay is a 1-point favorite on the road. Scott, who's winning this battle?
See, this one I was actually going back and forth all day on, because if you look at it, you know, both teams easily have a top 10 caliber offensive line. They both have a very similar offensive style with dual running backs. I think with the weapons that Atlanta have with Drake London and Kyle Pitts on the outside like that is going to be a mismatch, just nightmare for Green Bay. But the big question mark is Desmond Ridder and if he's going to get that offense going. I think if Green Bay could shut down the rush from Atlanta, they should have an easier time with it. But this is the second road game for Green Bay. There's still too many question marks on their defense. I'm going to go with the Falcons.
I'm a little surprised by that, but I'm with you on it. I've been going back and forth all day on this particular game. Like, that one has been a problem. So, Sue will help me really figure this out. Who are we taking in this game, Zoo?
So I think that Green Bay is going to be focusing heavily on the air while the Falcons keep it tight to the ground. I don't know if I have high expectations for either of those defenses, so it does come down to the quarterback play and how they're able to lead. I'm expecting the game to be somewhere in the 20s on both ends, but I think there's going to be love in Atlanta and the Packers are going to take it.
All right. You said the Packers are going to take it?
Yeah. Lots of splits going on.
I know. It's a lot of splits. I like the Falcons a lot. The only thing that concerns me with them are those first round pass catchers that they have there in Kyle Pitts.
I got Kyle Pitts on my fantasy. I know.
It seems to torture everybody every year. Kyle Pitts, he finally got something going, I believe, in the second half of that game, but Drake London wasn't doing shit in week one. There wasn't anything coming from that side, and I don't trust it to get any better going up against... I assume they'll have Jerry Alexander for Green Bay covering Drake London. Maybe they'll have him go to Kyle Pitts or just switch out and about. But either way, I much prefer the Green Bay Packers defense going up against that offense, even if they have Bijan Robinson and Tyler Algier really going. Plus, as much as I like Atlanta's defense, and we said it in the preview show about how Jesse Bates would affect how that defense plays, and you saw the playmaking ability that he had, especially helping out their corners, their really young star stud corners. I like Jordan Love, and what he was able to do even without Christian Watson was pretty impressive. So I'm looking to see him do it all again this week in Atlanta. Give me the Green Bay Packers. Now, we have a game that was slated to be the game of the week, and then it had to get a little bit booted. So, because, you know, Hall of Fame quarterback makes his big patriotic debut. What a debut that was, by the way. I'm not even a big, you know, I'm not a huge on we need to do the national anthem, the big flag showcase, but it was 9/11. You have the new, you know, the face of the league, Aaron Rodgers, come out with the flag, waving it. Lights are down, crowds going crazy. Boom, three plays later, everybody's dreams are dead. We're back to the New York Jets. Speaking of the New York Jets, it's the New York Jets who are 1-0. Going up against the Dallas Cowboys, who are also 1-0. Dallas is a 9.5-point favorite, though, going up against the Disney Prince, Zach Wilson. So, Scott, who do you want in this game? Do you have some faith in the New York Jets, 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 Jets?
R-E-G, Reds.
If Rodgers was under center, I would feel a lot more comfortable picking the Jets. But you got to look at this Dallas defense. Last week put up 7 sacks. They got 2 picks off of Daniel Jones, which I think we are all in agreement that Daniel Jones is a much better quarterback than Zach Wilson. Am I speaking crazy talk?
I don't know. I've been sticking my neck out for Zach Wilson for a couple of years now. I still think he's going to be good, and this is the time to prove it. So I'm going to say Zach Wilson's better than DJ.
That defense, I mean, they put that 40 bomb up on in New York against the Giants in that primetime game. I can't put my faith in the Jets right now. As much as it pains me to say, it's going to be the Cowboys, and it's going to be by a lot.
Unfortunately. Zoo, who do you have?
So I do have the Cowboys, but I don't know if it's going to be by a lot. I think that the Jets defense is still very underrated and they are going to make it difficult for Dak, but I don't know how much they'll be able to turn it around on offense, especially with Parsons chasing Zach Wilson around. So I think it will be by 10-15 points, like a touchdown and a half. But I am taking the Cowboys.
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, I just hate saying that.
I hate saying it too. That's why I'm going to mumble it now. I'm taking the Cowboys.
I think
it's going to be close. I agree with you guys. I agree with Zoo. I think it's going to be relatively close. That defense of the Jets, it's going to give Dak issues. He didn't have to do shit last week against the New York Giants. His stats were incredibly low. I think Quinnen Williams will be able to handle Tony Pollard, so it's going to be a little closer than we expect, but as much as I'm rooting for Zach Wilson, and I'll go ahead and throw out the hot take now. I think Daniel Jones is better than Zach Wilson, but I think that Zach Wilson is going to end up having the better career overall. Wow. Give it time. He is going to have Zach Wilson will have a better career than Daniel Jones. Book it.
Okay.
Also, he's going to throw probably like two. He's going to throw probably about three or four interceptions though against Trayvon Diggs and Stephon.
Absolutely.
Gilmore.
Well, that's my thing though. Like with Rodgers can extend drives. He can pick up those really important third down conversions or potentially a fourth down conversion here and there. I think if the Jets want to stay in it, they got to make sure that defense is getting the proper rest. So if they can split the time of possession going into the second half, it should be a close game. But if they're just getting three and outs, getting pick after pick, it's going to be a long day. That defense is going to get so tired.
Micah Parsons is going to feast. That dude's crazy.
I think it's the Diggs Wilson connection that I'm going to be most interested in, because yes, he gets a lot of interceptions, but when he slips up, he slips up.
Oh, he's a liability most times.
So it's just one of those things. They're going to see if Zach can get that connection going with him specifically.
Yeah. Final game here. What I like to think is the game of the week, because I think it's going to be a fun one. The Kansas City Chiefs, who are 0-1 at the Jacksonville Jaguars, who are 1-0. Kansas City is a 3.5-point favorite on the road. Could go up if it becomes official that Travis Kelce will play on Sunday. I think everybody's expecting him to play and be back. Scott, who do you want in this game?
You know what? Give me the Jags. Chiefs are going to start 0-2.
Pulling a sleepy Zoo.
Give me the Jags in a last-minute field goal. I think... Yeah, Chris Jones, he's returning. He got his contract for 1 year, whoop-de-doo, and he's should be an immediate improvement to that defensive line. I think, like you said, it's still kind of up in the air if Kelsey's going to be playing, but it's at home in Jacksonville. I'm pulling the Jags for that upset.
Zoo, you joining him?
Chris Jones versus Brandon Scherf. So this was really tough, and I was going back and forth for so long, but I think it's going to be a really tight game, and Mahomes is just going to pull out some magic at the last minute.
Hard to ever doubt that.
What a time we live in where the Jaguars are a threat to the Chiefs.
Isn't it great? And it's legitimate. It's not like, you know, the Blake Bortles threat of yesteryear where it's just like, you know, magic things are happening. You can actually fear Trevor Lawrence. He's getting good.
Yeah.
Well, and it's like, Trevor Lawrence could be able to put up some good points on that Kansas City defense if he just allowed the time in the pocket. But like the battle that I'm looking at in that game is going to be on the front lines. You have the blue chip edge duo in Jacksonville going up against the new offensive tackles in Kansas City. I just see them being abused.
So I had a tough time on this one, just like Packers Falcons. I want to take the Jaguars. I want the chaos. I want the messy chaos of the Jaguars beating the Chiefs here and the Chiefs falling to 0-2. But it's hard for me to ever doubt Mahomes. I think it's going to be a fun game. I think it's going to be a high scoring game, but I think Chris Jones coming back is going to cause a lot of damage out there. One thing we can't disregard here. Does Kadarius Toney get the same amount of playing time that he did in week one? There's not a chance, right?
You're going to see a lot more Sky Moore.
It was the worst performance by a receiver that I have ever like actually watched. And I think statistically it was up there as one of the worst, but it was so visibly bad where you can tell that they are single-handedly losing this game for him. I think if they had not played Kadarius Toney at all, they probably would have won the game. I think anybody else could have made a couple of those catches. Put Justin Ross out there. Justin Ross has some great potential. Put him out there. It would have been more fun than Kadarius fucking Toney doing all that. I think you get Travis Kelce back. If they get Kelce back, it's going to help out a lot. But I think regardless, they're going to win that game. Mahomes is going to turn it up. He'll be hungry for this. Losing opening night against the Lions is the perfect way to cure that Super Bowl hangover. And then you get your defensive tackle back. They're serious. They're ready to go. Give me the Chiefs. That's our Ricks versus Gricks, folks. We got good picks. You know what I'm loving is that this is the second week of Ricks versus Gricks, and we have not blanked a game. Like, we have not all taken the same team in one game. It is straight competition now. And somebody's getting this Grick title. I wonder if I could be the Grick. So then all of a sudden somebody has to be Rick. Somebody has to be Reed's picks.
That's just Rick squared.
Ooh. Oh, just or Gricks with a capital G and R.
Ooh.
Ooh.
The Rick is the Grick.
Well, look, since we talked about the Jets and we talked about all the trouble with Aaron Rodgers, I thought it was appropriate to bring out a quick top five here, top five I have been thinking of. And when you think about Aaron Rodgers getting hurt this year and you can't help but imagine what if, and you can't help but think about what glory they could have had in this first year. They legitimately could have been a Super Bowl contender with Aaron Rodgers this season. I think that's completely, completely out the window now. But what if he had stayed healthy? We have a show on the 323 Network. Emily Sissel asks, what if? This is in that vein. So I am giving you right now my top five injury what ifs in sports history.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1. This is the 323's top five.
Oh, shit. Here we go again.
That's right. The 323's top five injury what ifs in sports history. What if they had stayed healthy? That's what we're asking here right now. And before we get into the full list, I will give you OLIs, and an OLI on here is just death in general. Death does not qualify for the list. I think that's a whole other thing. So somebody like Sean Taylor, what if he, you know, had lived? Lynn Bias, what if he had lived? I think Lynn Bias would have been number one if that was a qualification on here. All the potential of like a Michael Jordan level player there. But that would be its own category, maybe a discussion for another day. I do have other legitimate OLIs for this list, and two, I think there are two that Scott could probably speak to. And the first one doesn't make my list. Drew Bledsoe. What if Drew Bledsoe had stayed healthy? I don't think that completely makes it, because I think Tom Brady would have taken over anyway. I don't know if you agree, Scott. You saw what was happening there in New England at the time, but if Tom Brady's greatness was truly that great, I think he would have just taken the job anyway, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So, doesn't make my list. The other one, the other of the final OLI was Colt McCoy and his busted shoulder at, he played Texas, right? It was Texas, mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yep.
And that I actually somehow didn't know, and it explains a lot about his throwing style and his arm power and the arm power or lack thereof. And I'd like to imagine that he would have been great. It's just his name speaks true quarterback star. Colt McCoy, come on, that would have been on.
Well, maybe he could be a Jets backup.
He could be a oh Jesus, he's out there. Number five on my list here of top five injury what ifs, Tony Romo in 2016. Tony Romo famously injured his back in 2016. He was going to miss a lot of playing time. Cowboys didn't know what to do. It's one of their best, like possibly their best O-line that they ever had at the time. Ezekiel Elliott was just drafted in the first round and expected to do great things. They still had, I believe, Dez Bryant going in at the time. They had a lot. There was a lot of great potential for that team. And you wondered, oh, shit, Romo's down. Now they're done. So who comes in? Their rookie quarterback, Dak Prescott. Dak Prescott lights it up. And Romo's starting to get healthier towards the end of the season. Everybody's wondering, did they give Romo the job back or do you let Dak keep it? They ultimately let Dak keep it, especially going into the playoffs. They lost first round. And you couldn't help but wonder, as Cowboys fans, what if Romo had been out there? He was the veteran, and in that particular situation, he probably could have used veteran mind, and it was the best team that Romo ever would have played for in his time in Dallas. Lost it there due to injury. Who knows what could have happened? Maybe that could have been the Super Bowl gateway that Jerry Jones had been looking for. We'll never know. And it's the unfortunate thing with all of these. You'll never know. Number four on my list, the lovable Bill Walton. Bill Walton, he's been argued. You know him for his commentary. You know him for his great shirts. And he one time ate a cupcake during a broadcast with the candle still lit on it. He's a wild guy. Tell crazy stories during boring-ass games and saves them for you. But he was argued. He was so injury-plagued, his back, everything, as a player. And it was argued that he could have been a Jokic level center, possibly the greatest center of all time, if it hadn't been for those injuries. Unfortunately, we'll never know. Number three, this one hits close to home, and I had to like really bump it down to, you know, make sure it wasn't biased and really think on it. But number three is Robert Griffin III. RG3 was fantastic that rookie year. It was incredible. And I'd argue to these Jets fans, look, you got Rodgers for like three plays, and that really hurts. That sucks. You have all that what-if potential. Think about us Skins fans at the time that we go through hell for decades on quarterback play, and then we get this dude from Baylor. He's a stud in college. We're excited, and he's actually living up to the excitement that rookie year. Killing it, doing all the stuff. Arm power is crazy. Running ability is crazy. And then the ACL goes out against the Baltimore Ravens. And then you're hoping that he's going to rehab it, but we have a playoff shot. And so we get to the wild card matchup against the Seahawks. RG3 comes out like a hero. He's playing all right, but you know he's playing injured. And what happens? Your greatest fear. The injury really completely buckles. ACL completely torn. He's done. Alters his career. His mobility has changed. Who knows? Confidence is shot. Everything in the organization changes, and, you know, it just falls to hell. We get Kirk Cousins, and it works out. Kirk Cousins is the backup, you know, with RG3.
And then first-round pick for the next 3 years.
Yeah, we lost that to the Rams. The Rams were assholes about it for 3 years, bringing out all those players for, you know, team captains. It was bullshit. And you always wonder what could have happened with RG3, and the pain of it got it to number three, but the reality of it to me was there was a lot of ego with RG3 too. And there was a lot of potential for him to fight and not learn how to play quarterback like an NFL quarterback. He was going to rely on that mobility forever, and it would have helped for a few years, but he was going to have to learn how to play out of the pocket, and that wasn't really happening so well during his rookie year. It definitely did not happen as he had to actually adapt later on. So I think we would have seen probably the same thing, but still, just the possibility sucks. Number two on this list, one that hurts, I think, NBA fans as a whole, but especially Bulls fans who have been long suffering since Michael Jordan, it is Derrick Rose. Derrick Rose, fantastic. He was incredible during the early start of his career with the Chicago Bulls. I had a great pair of shoes. It was my first pair of basketball shoes were Derrick Rose shoes. I love those shit. I ran them into the ground. I still have them somewhere. I can keep running them into the ground. Derrick Rose tore that ACL, getting the ACL, and it's just, he never recovers. It's consistent injury issues after that. Can never get to that actual, you know, fulfilled promise and potential. You always wonder what could be, and you wonder what could be with number one here. Number one, especially when I was looking at the stats, I couldn't help but think, damn, if he had just, even if he had just made it another year, I think it would have been a Hall of Famer. That is the brother of somebody that we talk about a lot on this show. It is Sterling Sharp.
Sterling Jackson Mahomes.
Yeah, Jackson Mahomes. Sterling Sharp is the brother of Hall of Fame tight end and, you know, great sparring partner on debate sports shows, Shannon Sharp. Sterling was a wide receiver for the Green Bay Packers, and during his seven-year career, he made five Pro Bowls. He was second in receptions and third in touchdowns during those seasons, both of those to Jerry Rice. And he had three first-time All-Pro selections, all of this in a seven-year career, and then neck injury. The fucking neck injury takes him out. Can't play anymore for his safety, for his health. He's had a great broadcast career since, but just a year after that injury, just a year, he missed out on the Packers Super Bowl winning team. He never got his ring. In fact, he wound up getting a ring from his brother Shannon, who won like three Super Bowls, and he felt that Sterling deserved one of those rings. But just to think of what the rest of Sterling Sharp's career could have been, it hurts. It hurts with all of these. And I wonder if Aaron Rodgers will make this list, but I also don't know if Aaron Rodgers is going to play again. We don't know. At his age at 39, I think it's a fair question. And I would ask you guys, what do you think the future is for Aaron Rodgers and the Jets, or is he going to join this list of, you know, what ifs here in the future?
I think he is going to come onto the field again at some point. Whether he's healthy enough to do much, or if he has to get benched, or I don't know what the future of it is, but I don't think it is going to be like, yeah, I'm done. Like, we are going to see him play a couple of games in a Jets uniform. Hopefully they use that offseason to draft O-line.
That would help. That would help. Scott, do you think he commits to the, they say it's an 8-month rehab for a torn Achilles. And we know how Rodgers' off seasons go. He likes his dark rooms. He likes the ayahuasca trips. You know, he likes exactly what Zoo's doing. He's doing the meditating and finger pulls. Who knows what else he's doing during all that time? He might be doing the whatever that noise was at Zoo. Yeah, there we go. But we know Rodgers likes his off seasons. We know he likes his time. We know he's a big universe guy too. And maybe this is a sign from the universe that he should have retired as a Packer. This shouldn't be happening. Do you think he tries to come back?
I mean, how many plays did he play? Four?
Three.
Three? And I know his contract is fully guaranteed money. It's a 2-year contract for $75 million. He's already going to get half of that. He's only took three snaps. I mean, even if he comes back next year plays out the last year of his contract, I could see him more or less retiring after next year. But I think with him still having a year of this guaranteed money, he ain't going nowhere.
No. Uh-uh.
And he doesn't give me the personality of, he doesn't strike me as somebody who would be like, nah, I'm done now. He thinks too highly of himself to give up at that. Get to hang it all up at because of that.
He really wants another ring.
If Alex Smith can come back after the detrimental injury that he had to his leg and still commit to he had another season or two after that leg injury. Mm-hmm. Yeah, he can come back.
He was a third string and still played in one multiple games. I think he only lost one game that he started in.
And that's what Aaron Rodgers will do. He'll be the backup to, you know, Super Bowl winning future Hall of Famer Zach Wilson.
Here's what they'll do. You got Kirk leaving Minnesota next year to go to sunny Southern California. Or he's going to go to San Francisco and play for that franchise, which leaves the Vikings without a quarterback, which means the Vikings are going to trade the Jets for Rodgers' last year of his contract. And Rodgers is going to go play in Minnesota like Favre did. And then he'll retire.
And Stafford will be his backup.
I do look. You bring up.
Aaron Rodgers is gonna sit on Stafford's shoulders, and Stafford has legs and Aaron has arms.
Oh my god!
And then they get Josh Dobbs's brain.
Stafford Rodgers.
You know he's an aerospace engineer.
On that note, I gotta go.
We love you, Zoo. Thank you for being here, buddy.
Bye, Zoo.
You can catch Zoo on the Animation Deliberation podcast. He's talking all great things. Yeah, I agree with you on Rodgers simply because of the contract. You take the pay cut for $1 million for $1 million this season, and then I think he'll be owed, I don't know how much that backed into next year, somewhere in probably in the 60s, close to $70 million range that he'll be owed next year. And of course, they'll figure out a way to distribute that money in other years or something. But yeah, he's not going to give up that. He's coming back for that money. He's going to come back for that money. He'll come back for like a cheap back David Bakhtiari. They'll get him from Green Bay somehow. They'll really go in on the O-line. It'll be a big story. He might say it's his last dance just to get that whole storyline going, get some documentary crews out there.
So I found an article that broke down exactly how much he's getting paid for the snaps that he's taken this year.
Oh shit!
So due to injury, Rodgers will make $9.375 million per snap.
Finesse king.
Jesus. I'm pretty sure I could last more than just three snaps out there. Jesus Christ, let me go out there and go get my shit pushed in.
That's a wonderful question, actually. I would love to ask the audience, how many snaps at NFL quarterback do you think that you could last? You're playing against a mid team at best.
Whose line do I have?
You have the Jets O-line. You have that Jets O-line.
Oh.
And you're going up against, who did they play that night? Did they play the Bills? I think the Bills are perfectly mid D-line. Von Miller's in there, but he's an older Von Miller.
I would be out there for one snap, because that one snap would be me just taking like a 10-step drop back and just chucking the ball and it being an interception. I would just like, no, I'm not going out there again. I'm done.
I'd last one snap. I would hear those grunts and screams and see how quickly those giant-ass 300-pound dudes are moving. Shit myself like Paul Pierce and have to be like wheelchaired off the field.
So what I'm saying, I'm immediately taking a step back and I'm just throwing it. I'm not gonna have time to react and read the defense or see where anybody's at. I'm just throwing the ball wherever it goes.
Oh. What is this Motown sound? That can only mean one thing. Because, of course, we saw last week that Calvin Ridley's back in the NFL.
The best things in life are free.
So we had to go out and find somebody who could be the face of the 323's betting slip. We love doing a betting slip. Last year we did the Calvin Ridley Memorial Betting Slip, which, you know, is an ode to him getting suspended for a full year for doing a 15 leg parlay, which is notably for people that are, you know, all the non-gamblers in the audience, you're not hitting a 15 leg parlay. So he got suspended for that. He got suspended for a full year and lost however many millions. So we decided to start doing weekly parlays and see if we could get close to it in Calvin's honor. But there were so many NFL suspensions this year for gambling that it was hard to really pick. But there was one particular area where players just kept getting suspended for gambling, including their actual front office people who were getting fired for it. And that brings us to this Motown sound and our segment for this NFL season, this version of Scott's Locks called the Detroit Lions Memorial Betting Slip. Welcome, Scott, to the new Hello. Betting slip.
There's no one more deserving to have the title of this betting slip this year than the Detroit Lions.
And look, with a new betting slip, with new music, with a new vibe, we had to bring a challenge to you. Because, I mean, we were, you know, you were hitting close, especially once we started adding, like, college teams. We were betting every game of the NFL week. But that's not totally in the spirit of Calvin Ridley, because I don't think he was doing teams. He went dangerous. He went like me, where you're putting $5 down and really believe that you might win that $790,000. So we gave you the challenge of you get one lock team to pick to win a game from this NFL week, week two. And from there on, you have to hit on one prop bet from every other game of the NFL week. I don't know if we're counting Monday Night Football. That's far out. We can get it all knocked out on Sunday in time for the Sunday hangover, but I'm leaving it up to you. You want a good challenge in here. And you even added to your challenge to make it a Survivor League and getting to where once you pick a team as your lock and your surefire win of the week, you can't pick that team again. So, Scott, I'm going to turn it over to you if you have this betting slip ready. I think we had to go to DraftKings because they're the only ones who put out prop bets on a Thursday because they know they're degenerates. So, host of College Shame Day, what do you got?
All right. Well, I was compiling this, and for some reason or another, I think 15 picks is the max on a parlay ticket for DraftKings. So, I had to keep it at 15 picks. And my game of the week, that was my lock of the week for my only team I'm allowed to pick, would have been the Dallas Cowboys. But just like the Raiders, I never want to give the Cowboys credit for anything, whether it's going to be me winning a ton of money. So I said, fuck the Cowboys this week. And I just, you know what, Reid? I'm going to pivot for this first one. And I went player props for all 15 really see what happens. And then next week we'll pick up after that.
Okay. All right. Let's see what you got.
All right. Well, we're going to roll it out. Ravens versus the Bengals. I'm picking Joe Burrow over 1.5 passing touchdowns this week. Chiefs at the Jags, Trevor Lawrence over 1.5 passing touchdowns. Raiders at the Bills, Josh Allen over 1.5 touchdowns. Seattle at Detroit, Jared Goff over 1.5 touchdowns. Niners at the Rams, folks, if you're keeping up, you're getting a trend, and you're correct. Matthew Stafford is also going to throw for over 1.5 touchdowns. Here's where the Cowboys game comes into play. So rather than picking them to win, I'm going to pick the milk hunter himself, Zach Wilson, over 0.5 touchdown. He's going to throw one, folks. He's going to get one.
Okay.
Then rolling into
the Chargers. I thought he was going to be the interception one this time.
I was very much contemplating doing that one. But no, I think Zach's good for one touchdown. I mean, you got Garrett Wilson. He's got plenty. You got Breece Hall coming out the backfield. He's got Dalvin Cook coming out the backfield. He's good for at least one. But then going into, you got the Chargers going to Tennessee. I'm taking Derrick Henry to rush for over 85.5 yards this week. Packers at the Falcons. Bijan Robinson also going over on his rushing yards total at 53.5. Bears in the Bucks. My game of the week this week. For folks who don't know, M is a huge Bears fan. I'm a Buccaneers fan. And even recently, I'm a big Florida State fan. M's been rooting for LSU Tigers. They had that first week game in college football. Now we're rolling into another game where we're going to hate each other for the rest of the week. I am picking Baker Mayfield to go over 8.5 rushing yards. He's bound to pick up a first down somewhere. You know, he's going to scamper out there a little bit. Colts at the Texans. As much as I don't want to give him credit for anything, I'm going to go with Anthony Richardson's rushing yards total at 43.5, but I'm taking the under. Under 43.5 rushing yards for Anthony Richardson. Giants at the Cardinals. We're going to go to the over 73.5 rushing yards for Saquon Barkley. Commanders at the Broncos. We're going to take the over 55.5 rushing yards for Brian Robinson Jr. Browns at the Steelers. Najee Harris over 50.5 rushing yards. Saints at the Panthers. This is another one that was, I found out was very silly, and I just had to take it. Derek Carr over 3.5 rushing yards.
Listen to me; those ones will always get you. That's the type of prop that killed me one time, where I took Tom Brady for over 2.5 rushing yards, and he got 4. And then that motherfucker took a knee to end the game. And all of a sudden,
that's what I'm worried about.
All of a sudden, the prop is dead. The whole parlay is dead.
And to round out the inaugural Detroit Lions betting slip of the week, we got the Dolphins at New England Patriots. Tyreek Hill over 84.5 receiving yards. This was a $10 bet that if all 15 of these player props hit, is going to net me $88,024.92. Let's go.
That's the spirit of Calvin Ridley. That's what we want. There we go. Scott and Ellia there. You're doing it for him. We're doing it for Rodgers. We're doing it for Aaron Rodgers' Achilles fund.
Yes.
We're going to get him. We're going to send him to wherever Peyton Manning went to get his neck fixed. Oh, ladies and gentlemen, that is Ricks versus Gricks. That was the Detroit Lions Memorial Betting Slip, and this is the 3-2-3. Thank you all for being here, for listening, for watching. If you're watching us on the 3-2-3 Network YouTube channel, that's for the audio audience. Go find us there and see our beautiful faces. See our mourning looks for Aaron Rodgers. I'm wearing red for, you know, the blood shed of Jets fans everywhere. Thank you to our resident Formerly casually confident Jets fan, Luis Martinez. Of course, you can check him out on Miente's show, Fireside Chats of Big Chief Burrito. Zuhair Ali, the host of Animation Deliberation. Find that wherever you get your podcasts. And of course, if you're going to be looking for podcasts, go find the 3-2-3 College Shame Day and its host, Scott Ellia. Thank you for being here, buddy. We'll be getting a show this week, right?
Yes, we will be getting a show this week, and it will be coming out Saturday before kickoff.
It's a weak week in college football, but I think there's still plenty to talk about, and I feel like we kind of dropped the ball because I'm seeing First Take and College Game Day and, you know, the Fox crew, they're all going to Colorado. I feel like we should have gone to Colorado.
No, I'm good. I'll give my view. I'm not going to give it now. I'll give my view on why College Game Day is going to Colorado. There's some Pac-12 talk that I am very happy to talk about. Might delve a little bit deeper into those who listened to last episode. We talked a little bit about Mel Tucker and what's going on in Michigan State. Might open up that a little bit. And then, of course, give the picks for Game of the Week, Lame of the Week, and the Wheel of Degenerate, which last week, folks, if you kept up with it, technically I was 3-for-5. Me, I believe I would have been 4-for-5, but of course, somebody didn't want to pick up the spread. Utah cost me and then my upset pick of the week of SMU over Oklahoma did not hit. So that Wheel of Degenerate, It might net me some positive funds here soon.
I was to say that Wheel of Degenerate, I think that's where the strongest picks were last year on the Calvin Ridley Memorial Betting Slip were the college picks. That really helped out. Now it's like very hard. But again, 3-2-3 College Shame Day. It's right here on the 3-2-3 with Reid Murphy podcast feed. Go check that show out. It's one of the best things that we've got going on at YouTube. The visual audience loves it. We've been getting very high on that. Reddit's also talked about it weirdly. So it's the show has hype. Go find us. We're the predominant college football show. And that's the predominant college football host there, Scott Ellia. Thank you for being here, buddy. We love you. We love all of you listening and watching the show. We will talk to you soon. We have a Sunday hangover right after the NFL games. It'll be during the Sunday night game, so you should be able to catch it Sunday night or very early Monday morning. You'll want to hear all our thoughts, and whoever pops onto the show, it's going to be a fun one. I've got a lot of weird shit to talk about during that show, including a James Bond theme song I just found out. I got a game to play involving FIBA basketball players, and yeah, some other shit. There were robots at the Chargers game. We didn't even get into that, so I have to bring that up this Sunday. I found that out in the barbershop conspiracy talk. So,
hot damn.
It's a lot. You don't want to miss it, folks. The Sunday hangover on Sunday. It's the 3-2-3. Again, at 3-2-3 Reid on all social media platforms. Follow us. We love you guys. Thank you for supporting and following us. We will talk to you soon. Stay safe, everybody. That's what I want.